Beginning from today, I'd like to begin a new series from the book of Ephesians. A great chapter, a great letter, a great epistle written by Apostle Paul. William Barclay, one of the most popular New Testament commentators and English scholar, calls this was the queen of the epistles that Apostle Paul wrote. The queen of epistles. If you have great delight in reading God's Word, if you could read Ephesians and Colossians side by side, he points out that we have at least 53 references verbatim repeated, or maybe with slight variation in both of these epistles. A great epistle that talks about who we are in Christ. My intention is to bring to you some meditations about our own call as a church. When I say us, we're not talking about India International Church, I'm talking about the Church Universal. I'm not sure if I told the story, probably I did. You know, a few months ago, maybe a year ago or so, I talked about how the great scientist Albert Einstein was traveling by train. You remember that story? Sissy, do you remember Sissy? I asked Sissy because she very faithfully takes down notes. That's why I thought she had recovered. Okay, Einstein was one day traveling by train somewhere in the East Coast. And when the ticket examiner got into the compartment, when he recognized the great scientist sitting there, the man felt so honored and he walked up to him and said, "Dr. Einstein, what a privilege that you are traveling by my train today, my compartment." And Dr. Einstein thanked him for his kindness. And then the man said, "Can I have your ticket, sir, please?" So Dr. Einstein reached out his pocket to take the ticket. The ticket wasn't there. Oh. And looked at the other coat pocket. It wasn't there. He reached out his side pocket. It wasn't there. He reached out to his slacks, pants, and it wasn't there. The man began to get embarrassed. He said, "Excuse me." He opened up his briefcase, looked for that, it wasn't there. It took some time, and the man was waiting. He couldn't find the ticket. And Einstein was feeling terribly embarrassed. And then the man said, "Dr. Einstein, sir, don't worry. We all know who you are. I don't need it. I'll take it. Don't worry about it." Saying that, the man went away, and he went and checked every other passenger. It took about 10 minutes or so for him. After he was done with every passenger, the examiner returned. When he returned, he has to pass by Dr. Einstein. When he came closer to him, he saw something that was incredible. This great scientist was all on his fore, on his knee, bending under the seat, still looking for the lost ticket. A great scientist, a Nobel Prize winner for whatever physics, right? So he said, "Dr. Einstein, sir, don't worry about the ticket. We all know who you are." Einstein turned to him and said, "I know who I am, but I don't know where I'm going." Funny. Dr. Billy Graham told that story in one of his crusades in the New York Yankee Stadium. You know, a panic attack triggered by a lost or misplaced train ticket momentarily paralyzed the memory power of a great scientist, resulting in a temporary amnesia. I'm sure Einstein recovered his memory rather quickly and he knew where he was going. And then Dr. Graham challenged the audience. Einstein said, "I know who I am, but I don't know where I'm going." The challenge to people of the world, including the so-called Christians, is, do we know who we are? And do we know where we are going? I believe this episode, like many other portions of the scripture, would help us to find out. The first portion, we are going to talk about who we are. What's our identity? There are many things we take ourselves for granted. What kind of people are we? The tragedy among many Christians, so-called Christians around the world, is there seems to be suffering from a permanent amnesia, unlike Einstein's temporary one. They don't seem to know who they are, and they don't seem to know where they are going. They may think who they are, but what they think may not be altogether right. They may think they know where they are going, perhaps they never reach where they are going. And so in Ephesians, the Apostle Paul reminds the church which we also will try to find an answer to in the succeeding weeks beginning from today. Who are we vis-a-vis the rest of the people of the world? How different are we from the rest of the people of the world? Why has God created us? Why has God specifically placed us in His church, His body, as members of the body? What does God really expect from us? Including a Sunday worship service like this, although we're just a handful of people here. It makes a great thing for God. Does that make great for us? And in each chapter, the apostle addresses one or two aspects of those four questions. It's my plan now to go on till the last chapter, taking one chapter at a time. It is not all the time I'm going to do an expository study like word by word or words by words like we did with the book of James. But rather I'm going to be calling your attention to a key verse in each chapter as Paul presents it. And then focusing our attention on key words, talk about the implications of who we are. Why has God created us? Why has God specifically placed us in the church as members of His body? What is it God expects from us? So we're going to take one key word from each chapter and dwell on it. And today, in chapter 1, the key verse is verse 4. He chose us in Him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in His sight, and then we'll continue on from there. And in this verse, Paul talks about that we are a privileged people. In verse 3, praise be to God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing. We are a blessed people. Let me call we are a privileged people. What is this privilege? And I believe that this meditation will help us to prepare ourselves to more meaningfully and effectively participate at the holy table of the Lord in the end of the service. To that end, we invite you to kindly pray with me for the Holy Spirit's light to be shed upon our meditation of God's Word. Let us pray. Gracious Father, we thank you for another opportunity that you have given us to come together as your children to worship you, to expose ourselves to God's Word. The immortal, eternal Word of God, the never-changing Word of God, which is so relevant and applicable and challenging to the ever-changing world. The Holy Spirit of God, inasmuch as He inspired Apostle Paul to write these words down for us almost 2,000 years ago, and how the Word was so meticulously and carefully preserved by the Church all these centuries and is being passed on from generation to generation, and today we are the privileged recipients of God's Word. And as we look into God's Word, we ask if you, just as He inspired the Apostle, now illuminate our understanding the meaning of your Scripture. Enable us not only to comprehend the Word of God with clarity, but help us to receive the Word of God joyously in our hearts, and then also give us the power of the will to abide by what the Word of God has to speak to us, as individuals and as a church. To that end, we pray that the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our Rock and our Redeemer. And the people of God said, Amen. Amen. The key words here is, praise be to God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing. We are blessed people. You know, the word blessing, when you talk about blessing, most people tend to think in terms of material blessing. Now, material blessing is not excluded from God's blessings, especially as you visit the Old Testament. Beginning, say, from Abraham and on, God blessed them richly. He made them successful in all they did. God made them prosperous. If you think of David, you think of Solomon, they're very affluent people. But if you go and you have an interview with David and ask David, David, you have been such a blessed man. You know, God lifted you up from such a humble background, being a shepherd boy. As we recall, I think, on the December 31st night, you know, being a shepherd is no big deal. You don't have to be a big expert how to take care of the sheep. In those days, parents would send whom they consider the least deserving boy, the useless boy, you go take care of the sheep. Your brothers saw strong and muscular, let them go and serve Saul, the royal army of the king. You are not fit for even for a military service, alright? From that such a humble background, God lifts him up and makes him the greatest king of all Israel, even today. Even today. It's the David star that the nation of Israel uses as an official symbol. So if you talk to David, you are a great hero, you slain the lion. You are a blessed man. So David, tell me, what is the greatest blessing? I bet you, he's not going to talk about becoming a king or a popular hero. He's going to talk about the spiritual blessings. As we counted in Psalm 103, you know? Bless the Lord, O my soul, all that is within me, bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits or privilege. And what is the first one? He forgives your sins. That's the first thing he taught. He forgives. You know, there are many Christians, we don't normally think about the spiritual blessing that you have been blessed with. May it help us tonight as we get to communion. We thank God for the financial blessings. We thank God for the health blessings. You know, Achin, I just told us about 8 years. God has been so faithful. If you ask Achin, he will tell you. Yes, it's great to be blessed with good physical health, is that right? We thank God for that, for our health, for our strength, for our healing, for giving us a job, for giving us a good income, for giving us a good house. It's all wonderful, we thank God for that. But the greatest is, here Paul says, the God our Father, our Lord Jesus Christ, blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing. What a privilege! The privilege that today you and I enjoy. A lot of people in the world, millions of them, billions of them, don't have the privilege to enjoy. And we should be grateful for that. It's a unique and a great privilege. It is unique because there are several things involved here. In fact, from verse 4 to 14, the Apostle Paul lists 7 blessings. And the number 7 denotes perfection in the scripture. 7 blessings. Very quickly, I'm going to point out in succession to you. In fact, verses 4 to 14 is one long verse. Paul has written in a lyrical style. It's a lyric, one long song-like. But for the benefit of our own understanding, the scholars have put commas and some full stops over that, so the reading will be more comprehensible. It is the greatest of all privileges because, number one, we have been blessed in the heavenly realms. 2-3 times in the scripture, Paul makes a reference to how we have been blessed in the heavenly realms. Look at, for example, in chapter 2 and verse 6. God has raised us up in Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms. We'll see more of it in chapter 3 and chapter 6. I'll explain more in detail when we get there. So, it's the greatest of all privileges because we have been blessed in the heavenly realms. Number 2, we have been blessed in Christ 7 times again. That denotes perfection. That Paul says we have been blessed in Christ. Look at verse 3 for example. That God has blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ. Verse 4. For he chose us in him or in Christ. And verse 6. To the praise of his glorious grace which he has freely given us in the one that is Christ he loves. Verse 7. In him we have redemption. And verse 11. In him we were also chosen. Verse 13. And he also included in Christ. And verse 14. Who is the deposit guaranteeing inheritance until the redemption of those who are God's possession marked in him. Verse 13. Having believed, you are marked in him. In Christ 7 times. Again, 7 denotes perfection. Blessed in the heavenly realms, blessed in Christ, and a 7-fold blessings. What are the 7-fold blessings? Number 1. It is a blessed privilege of our election. Verse 4. He chose us in him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight. We should be grateful to God that we have been a chosen people. When did God elect us or choose us? It says before the creation of the world. So even before all the things we read in the book of Genesis, that God created everything, the cosmos, the light, the sun and the moon and the stars, the mountain, the hills and the valleys and the hills, and the oceans and rivers and the ponds and everything, the animals, the plantation, and the humans. Before God started creating human life, he says, even before the creation of the world, God chose us. He had seen us. So our being together as a church today is not something that we put together. Of course, there is a human element involved in it, but it's God who originated it. Our being together tonight is not something that we decided to come and worship God. God has seen it all. Even before the creation of the world, you and I and all God's children, billions of them around the world, were in his mind. It's amazing, isn't it? He had seen it. We are seeing February 1st only today, but the Lord saw February 1, 2009, before the creation of the world. It's amazing. God chose us before the creation. When? Before the creation. Why did he choose us? To be holy and blameless in his sight. We are called to be a holy people. We are called to be blameless people. Holy means separated from the world and separated for God. What is that supposed to mean by way of an implication? If God chose us before the creation of the world and he destined us to be holy and blameless in his sight, what does that mean to us by way of an implication? To me, that means God's strong confidence in us. In you, in me, of all the peoples of the world, God has chosen you and me, in our context today, that we may be holy and blameless in his sight. Because look at the world in which we live today. We live in a world of wickedness manifested everywhere. A lot of things people do and say, which really, really hurts the heart of God. But he has chosen us that we may live a holy life, a blameless life. We will not give an inch or space to the evil one to find fault with us. What a confidence. That it means it is easy for us to trust God because God is trustworthy and God will never fail. Is that right? It is easy for us to trust God because God never fails and is trustworthy. The question is it easy for God to trust us? How trustworthy are we? How often do we not fail God? And yet he trusts us. Now when you look at the book of Job, in general many people say, wow, look at Job. What a great confidence Job had in God. In the midst of all his suffering, even when his wife comes and tells him, why do you have to live like this? Curse God and die. God has taken everything. And his response was, don't talk like a foolish woman. God gave me and God took away. God gave me everything. God took away everything. Praise be to God. That was his response. But when you look at those words, we say, what a great confidence Job had in God. That being true, there's another side to that. The other side is, what a great confidence God had in Job. It was like a gamble that day, wasn't it? Satan coming and challenging, you know why Job is so faithful to you, God? Because you have blessed him with wealth and riches and health and strength, and he's the greatest man on earth. No wonder he's grateful. Now you touch him and take away everything and see how faithful will he be to you. And God, what was God's response? All right, I'll give you that. Go and try. When God said that, you go and try my servant Job, that shows what a great confidence God had in Job. God was betting. God seems to be taking a risk that day with Satan, betting on Job. Just think for a moment, hypothetically speaking. What if Job had succumbed to the temptation and fell out of his faithfulness to God? God would have been humiliated in the presence of Satan. Satan would laugh at God. Hey, he told you, you fell. Look at Job. He let you down. Job did not let God down. Because God knew we will not. The same thing God has got with us. Just think about it for a moment. God trusts us. He's got a great confidence in us. It's as if there's a game going on in those places. But Satan is every day challenging God. What about this man? What about that lady? What about this person? What about that person? They all call your children, you know. You take away everything from them and see how they're going to live. Whatever happened to Job and not happened to us, that great intensity of magnitude. But the question is, God has put our trust in us. That's why he's chosen us before the foundation of the creation of the world to be blameless and holy in his sight. and God trusts us, that's why He chose us. It's a great privilege that we have been found favorable to God, that God has put His trust and confidence in us. Will we let God down in the face of Satan? Number two, the blessed privilege of our adoption in verse 5. He predestined us to be adopted as His sons, but I would say as His children, because it includes daughters. Adopted as His sons through Jesus Christ in accordance with His pleasure and will, to the praise of His glorious grace, which He has freely given us in the one He loves. The second privilege is the blessed privilege of our adoption as God's children, God's sons. When He says God's sons, He's not only talking about men, He's also included women, but there's a Jewish way of writing in the literature. We are God's children. God has adopted us. The implication is by adoption, we become siblings of Jesus. Is that right? God's only son is Jesus. The rest of us are adopted by Him into His family. So that what does that make Jesus to us? He is our brother. We are siblings. Normally we think of Jesus as our Lord, as our Savior who died on the cross, which is very true, which is most essential. At the same time, relationally, He is our brother. That's why we read in Romans chapter 8 and verse 29, the apostle says, "For those God foreknew, He also predestined to be conformed to the likeness of His Son, so that He might be the firstborn among many brothers," and of course there is sisters. And you will recall, in Mark chapter 3, verse 34 to 35, I have got your attention many times in the passage, where when one day Mother Mary and Jesus' brothers came to see Him, when somebody came and told, "Your mother and brothers are outside looking for you," and Jesus said, "Who are my brother and my mother?" And then He looked at the people seated in the circle around Him and said, "Here are my brother, here are my mother and my brothers. Whoever does God's will is my brother, my sister, my mother." You know, we never think of our relational relationship with Jesus, our personal relationship with Jesus. Jesus is not only our Creator, our God, and our Savior, and our Master, and our Lord. He's also our brother. So in other words, God is bringing us to that family relationship and giving us the status to be considered as siblings of Jesus. We are brothers of Jesus. We are sisters of Jesus. So Scripture is speaking, it will be absolutely wrong, it will not be absolutely wrong to address Brother Jesus. Not only Lord Jesus, Master Jesus, Savior Jesus, we could call Him my Brother Jesus. On what basis? On the basis of what He Himself said. If you do my will, you are my brother. You are my sister. What a status. Do you ever think about it? It's a great privilege to be brothers and sisters of Jesus Christ Himself. And because of that, in Romans 8, 14 to 17, we are called to be not only siblings of Jesus, even share wholeness with Jesus. We are called to be co-heirs with Jesus. Let me just quickly read it to you. Romans 8, 14. "Because those who are led by the Spirit are sons of God. For you did not receive a spirit that makes you a slave again to fear, but you received a spirit of sonship. And by Him we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit Himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children." Now if we are God's children, then we are heirs, heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ. Indeed, if you share in His suffering, so on and so forth. We are co-heirs with God, share wholeness. Therefore, if you are co-heirs with Jesus, the implication is whatever blessing God the Father poured out on His Son as a human, when He lived on the face of the earth, whatever blessing God the Father poured out on His Son as a human, God is willing to pour out on us. And this is a great adoption. And then Paul qualifies the three distinctive aspects of this adoption. First, it says it's a predestined adoption. We have been predestined. And number two, he says it's a very pleasant and a pleasing adoption. That God, with His pleasure and will, adopted us. That means God is so happy with us that He has adopted us as His children. And number three, it's a price-free adoption. It has been done by a freely given grace in the one He loves. It goes on and on. What a privilege. It costs us nothing. to be adopted as his children. Absolutely nothing. But it cost God his most precious son, whom he sacrificed on the cross. Number three, the blessed privilege of our redemption. In verse 7 and 8, in him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, in accordance with the riches of God's grace that he lavished on us with all wisdom and understanding. We have received redemption through his blood. But it cost us nothing. It cost Jesus his very life, every drop of his blood. He paid the price. That's why we sing, we'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon the cross. And what is this redemption? Paul says, the redemption which is the forgiveness of our sins. So when people ask us the question, are you saved? What they really mean is, have you been forgiven? That's the greatest blessing. Forgiveness is the crux of the gospel. Any gospel preaching, however good and nice, encouraging and appealing it may sound to the hearers, if that preaching does not emphasize or focus on the forgiveness of sins by the blood of Christ and Christ alone, it is not a gospel at all. Let me repeat. Any so-called gospel preaching, you hear many of them do on the TV, on the radio, here and there. Any so-called gospel preaching, however good and nice and appealing and encouraging, motivating, inspiring, it may sound to the hearer, if it does not focus on or emphasize on the forgiveness of sins by the blood of Christ and Christ alone, is no gospel at all. Every time I visit India, even when I live there, I hear about all this. Even now, when I was traveling by car and other things, and traveling to Rani by car for 3 hours, again from Rani to other places, wherever we go, and in Chennai, everywhere we go, I see these big posters with evangelists, their pictures and the attractive photographs and miracle crusades, miracle rallies, and people are flocking there in hundreds and in thousands because healings are taking place. Thank God, healings are taking place. But the gospel is not just about physical healing. Of course, the word of God declared, Jesus went about teaching and preaching and healing people. But if Jesus performed the miracles, his concern was that miracles will open the eyes of the people, that they may see he's the Savior of the world. I wish I had the time to more elaborate. Later on, if you refer to Mark chapter 2 and verses 1 to 12, they brought him a man who was paralyzed. And Jesus looked at the man. Instead of straightaway healing him, he said, "Son, your sins are forgiven." Instead of telling the man, "Get up and walk," he said, "Son, your sins are forgiven." And the Pharisees and others looked offense at him. How dare he talk like that? Who is he to forgive sin? Forgiveness only belongs to God, and this man is committing a blasphemous act. He is committing a sin against God by forgiving people. And then Jesus challenged them, turned around and said, "Which is easier to say? Your sins are forgiven, or you are healed?" Alright? Because if you say you are healed, how do they know you are the God? Unless the man who is sick gets up and walks. That is the evidence that you are indeed healed. But to say you are forgiven, what is the evidence? It comes by faith. So in order to prove that he has the authority to forgive sin, he says, "Now to show that I have the authority, now I tell you, get up and walk." And the man walked away. In other words, Jesus was using a miracle. Many times as a means to a higher end. Forgiveness was the centrality of the gospel, the crux of the gospel Jesus always preached. He came to save us. He came to forgive us. He came to redeem us. That's why in Mark chapter 14 and verse 9, you know, the sinful woman, when she came and anointed his head and broke the alabaster jar of very expensive perfume and poured out on him. And people said, somebody said, I think Judas who said that, "Why all this waste of money? She could have sold this and given to the poor." And Jesus said, "Leave her alone." And then he said one thing. Wherever the gospel is preached, what this woman did for me today will be proclaimed to the whole world. Only one woman Jesus recognized. Wherever the gospel is preached, what this woman did for me should be proclaimed. He didn't say about anybody else anything else. Because this woman has received forgiveness. Salvation. So he said, wherever the gospel is preached, what she did to me must be remembered, must be